Hello everyone, ready to start. There are great challenges on the way of today's world. Building the Future is a series of webinars about Politecnico di Milano's research activities and results that do address most of those challenges. I am Gianluca Valenti, and I welcome our speaker, and I welcome all of you on today's seminar about planning the future of urban mobility. I am extremely happy to present a colleague from Politecnico di Milano, Professor Pierluigi Coppola, who is a professor in the Mechanical Engineering Department in the field of transport planning, which is a new field here in Politecnico because Pierluigi joined us just a little bit more than 1 year ago. So his research activities are mainly related to land use and transport interaction, travel demand forecasting, as well as transport project appraisal. Also, Pierluigi is active on the professional level as a consultant to our Ministry of Infrastructure and Transport, as well as he sits in a number of important places. In particular, he is part of the chair of the board of the Association of the European Transport, as well as he is coordinator of EU projects. I think it's about time for you, Pierluigi.
Thank you. Please. Thank you very much, Gianluca, and welcome everybody connected from all over the world, I guess. Thank you for this kind introduction. The title of the lecture today is Planning the Future of Urban Mobility, Green, Smart, and Fair Solution. But before outlining the content of this presentation, I would like to spend just a couple of minutes, just a few slides, to introduce you to transportation planning and to what is the role of planners today that is actually supporting policymakers in basically two main activities: understanding current criticalities of the transportation system, in my case, and trends towards the future. That is the so-called business as usual scenario. But also, on the other end, support in taking the right decision about policy and investment to drive the change toward desirable future scenario. Actually, what the decision maker expects from us, planners, is to get the best of new technology available and to avoid any negative and unintended consequences of our policy. So actually, this is a decision-making problems that can be summarized in four basic questions: that is where we are now, that deals with the current scenario analysis and the trends of the evolution, where we want to go and how we want to, and what will guide us in the change that is related to the definition of the objectives and the selection of the strategies. And last but most important for us as engineers is how we will get there, meaning which will be the projects, which will be the most suitable actions that will that will allow us to reach our goal. And actually, the outline of my presentation today reflect this flow, this process. In the first part, I will briefly introduce you to which are the driver of change in transport and mobility sector. Then I will present the goal of the overall goal of sustainable mobility and possible strategy to get there. And in the second part of the presentation, I will show you some case studies, research and practical studies developed here at the Politecnico di Milano. So drivers of changes in transport and mobility. The first driver of changes, in my opinion, are transport externalities, that are the impacts of transport on environment and society. You may be aware of how transport sector affect air quality in our city. It's common, it's our daily experience, but also how much the transport sector impact on global warming and is responsible for climate change. Think that about 25% nowadays of the emission of CO2 is related to transport, and in the future this percentage is expected to rise up to 30-50%. Second externality is traffic congestion. We all experience hours lost in traffic. An estimate at European level tells us that we spend about 2 days every year, each person spends 2 days every year in traffic. And road accidents is another important, maybe the most societal relevant externalities of transport. Think that 1.35 million of people died every year in traffic accidents. Last but not least, land consumption. Land consumption relates to the visual impact of roads or transport, but also on the physical occupation of space. And here I would like to challenge you with this first polls about land consumption. I'm asking how many square meters are occupied, in your opinion, by 100 people traveling by car, by bike, and by bus. The result, first of all, and actually 63%, the majority, says that traveling by car, it's 1,000 square meter, 150 by bike, and 80 square meters by car. And actually, this is the correct answer. At a glance, you can see in this picture how much car you need and how much space you need. It's occupied by 100 cars, 100 bicycles, and 100 people in a bus. I think it's much more impressive viewing at that than looking just and the numbers. Anyhow, I think you are correct. Your perception were correct. Good. Second driver in transport, driver change in transport and mobility relates to changing travel behavior on the one end. That means that today we move much more than in the past, and also our trip change are more articulated and have an increased complexity. Our trip change are multimodal, involving more than one single mode, and multipurpose, meaning that in one single travel, we can do a lot of activity, going to gym, going to shopping, to take a coffee, going also to work, and then going back home. On the other end, transport and mobility, the supplier service and mode of transport is also increasing. Today we have new modes of transport, like for example scooter, as you can see in the picture, and all the other means that are called micro mobility. But you also have new mode of transport in the way in which the modes are utilized, and I'm referring here to the shared mobility, the way in which we can nowadays use vehicles that are also in not our ownership. And last but not least, people today are much more aware of which are the alternatives to move to from on a given specific origin destination, thanks to the travel planners and to the smartphone apps that allows us to share mode to share also information and to be more aware of what are the options for moving, in particular in the urban context. Last but not least is the third driver of change that relates to the emerging technologies. Of course, today emerging technology are related to new kind of vehicles like electric vehicles, but also devices and facilities that are available on the vehicles. I'm referring to connection. Nowadays vehicles are more and more connected to the infrastructure, connected to people, connected each other, and in the future this connection would also improve the way and the safety thanks to smart infrastructure that would allow us to drive more safely and more aware of what is going to happen in around the vehicles. Last but not least, this is the future, even if not so far away, it's the autonomous driving. Autonomous driving relates to vehicles that are able to move without any steering in some extreme cases in our roads interacting with other vehicles and pedestrians. I will come through autonomous vehicle when presenting one of the case studies in the second part of the lecture. Now, again, we have seen many drivers of changes, and here is the second pole I would like to propose to you. And the question here is, of all the changes that we have seen, which, in your opinion, will be mostly affecting transport sector in the next year? Okay, let's start showing the result.
Wow, everywhere.
Well, about everywhere, yes. So everywhere. The drivers has attracted your attentions. But actually, in fact, this is true. I think that there are some driver that overcome the other. But the real question is, of all these driver, to which future will lead us, and in particular, is what we should ask ourselves: is this future scenario, this business as usual scenario, desirable, sustainable for us? Actually, in this slide, I have introduced some colors that cluster all the drivers according to three different dimensions: environmental, economical and technological, and societal dimension. And these are the three pillars, the three dimensions of our keywords when thinking about our future, that is sustainability. Actually, the concept of sustainable development, that is our overall goal for the future that relates to different fields, to different sectors, not only to transport and mobility, is sustainable development. And this was introduced many decades ago by this very famous report from the World Commission on Environment and Development, the Brundtland Report, Our Common Future. And actually, this has informed the policy of the last 20, 30 years. In particular, in the transport sector, the goal of sustainable mobility is that goal that meets the need of the society to move freely, to gain access, to trade and establish relationship, while at the same time keeping the human and ecological resources of the planet for the present and the future generation. In order to do or to develop a sustainable mobility scenario, there are possible strategies. In particular, I've listed in the slide the ones that have that are the most popular, let's say, and those that are proposed in many agendas at single state and city level. For example, decarbonizing transport, boosting the uptake of clean vehicles and alternative fuels, promoting modal shift from the car to more sustainable mode of transport such as cycling, rail, local public transport, improving safety and also improving accessibility and social inclusion. Actually, a sustainable mobility is a mobility that is that includes all the three dimensions of the sustainable development. And this leads me to the third part of this presentation, the ones related to the case studies. And what I'm going to present is three case studies that we have developed, and some of them are still undergoing, that relates to the three dimensions. The first one relates to the uptake of clean vehicles and alternative fuels. And the study area in this case was the provinces of Como, Lecco, and Varese, north of Italy, where you have about 19 public transport companies and about 860 circulating buses every day for a total of 30 million kilometers traveled per year. The problem here is that the fleet is very old and it is all diesel powered. So all the buses are with the internal combustion engine. The problem is then to identify which is the most suitable technology, both for the urban case of the city of Lecco, Varese, and Como, and for the exurban context, depending on economic and environmental and their economic and environmental impact. So, moving from the current scenario that include just diesel engine towards more clean vehicles such as electric one or those based on hydrogen fuel or hybrid one. And in doing this, in trying to identify this solution, we take into consideration both cost of vehicle fuel, also new recharging infrastructure, and also CO2 emission and pollutant. To do that, we apply what is very what is the most appropriate methodology to do that, that is the life cycle assessment of investment or a policy, that is a tool for quantifying the impact in order to assess along all the lifetime the environmental impact, taking into account all the steps that lead from the extraction of raw material to vehicle manufacturing, fuel cycle, fuel use, and then end of life, disposal, or recycling of vehicles. The result shows that in some cases you have different performances and different behavior, different technology that is relevant, in particular for, as you can see, the diesel and the gases like CNG and LNG that still have a very high percentage of emission, tank to wheel, as it said, so for the use, in the use of the vehicles. Some other that has a very reduced tank to wheel emission, but require or produce a lot of CO2 emission in the production, so the green bars relate to the production of the fuel, to the production of in the phase well to tank. Okay, so taking into account all this consideration, the results show that while in the urban context
The full electric scenario is the most impacting one and the most cleaning one, and actually here on the right hand side of the slide you can see how the transition to a green fleet has been planned for the basin of Como, Lecco and Varese. In the exurban case this is not possible, and this would not be possible in all those cases in which you have very long distance to be traveled by buses, you have high steep of the path of the routes, and a big gradient in temperature that makes electric engine not very much efficient. The second case studies relates to another project that has been developing at the Department of Mechanical Engineering of the Politecnico of Milano, aiming at the development of, the project is called TenVane, and TenVane is the name of the vehicle allowing for tele-driving, so driving at distance, and autonomous driving. Actually, the technology is there, and this vehicle is equipped with all the state-of-the-art technology that allow to move on roads in promiscuity with pedestrian and with other vehicle. As you can see here, it is equipped with cameras, with GPS, with radars, with LIDARs and antennas. But the focus of my group in this research was not that of developing the technology of this vehicle, this is work of my colleague mechanical engineers, but as transport planner I'm interested in what would be the socioeconomic and individual factor that will affect the adoption of this new technology in the future. Actually, what can be outlined is a twofold. What at the moment we can imagine is that there could be two approaches to connected and autonomous driving, ownership based and consumption based, meaning that you can replace your own vehicle with an autonomous one, but you can also skip ownership and just use them in as you today do with sharing vehicles, so in shared use, or as a collective, as a public transport means. We call it robo taxi. So actually the way in which in the future autonomous driving will be introduced and will be used is crucial, because if it will be replacing private car, nothing happened in terms of, for example, land consumption. Maybe these will be electric, so less impact on our quality, but nothing on land consumption, nothing on traffic congestion, and on occupation of spaces. Whereas if this vehicle would be able to replace the car and make a more efficient public transport, well, this would be much more desirable and sustainable. In order to see what is the attitude of individuals toward these two approaches, these two uses of vehicles, we did some survey and start investigating travel behavior with the use of behavioral models. Actually, this is travel demand models. Travel behavior forecasting is part of the work of a transport planner. And the first step is making polls, asking people about what they perceive about the new technology and how they are going to use it. So this leads us to the third and last polls of today. And actually, I would like to ask you, how likely would you use a connected and autonomous vehicle? How likely would you buy it? And how likely would you share a ride in the form of robo-taxi or autonomous bus, for example, on a connected and autonomous vehicle? So let's see the result.
Numbers are going up.
numbers are going up and will be updated. But as you can see, there is a new, a big percentage of respondents that are going to use in a scale from one that are very likely to use an autonomous vehicle. Less are going to buy, though 3.2 means that they are almost neutral, so they are in the not yet decided, and more are going to share a ride. Then I will show the result of our survey, of our poll, and actually, as you can see, it reflects also the answer that you have shown. There is a high percentage of people that are willing to use it, less are going to buy, and a little bit more to share. So actually, your
perfectly
answer reflects those overall of the overall result of our surveys. Just to tell you that this is very much related to socioeconomic factor. So we can say that, for example, these are age and education, as we were commented before, but also the level of income, car ownership, license driving holding, and attitudes towards public transport, and also the place in which you live, because people that live in big city are more prone to share a ride, because in big city, at the moment, you already have shared modes and shared option for car, bike, and other mode of transport. Good. The last case study is more focused on the third dimension of sustainability, that is social inclusion. And actually, this is related to a project called Tribute about user participation and co-design in urban mobility policy. The goal here is involving citizens and stakeholders in the identification of mobility policy and the technology, and also in the experimentation and evaluation of them in real life use cases. Actually, the goal of Tribute, that is an Adrian Interreg, so is a cooperation program in the Adriatic and Ionian region involving 8 cities from the 8 countries in the region, led by the Politecnico di Milano. The aim of this project is that of developing a living lab on urban mobility. The living lab concept is based on dissemination of information about urban mobility, but also discussion with stakeholders and citizens in order to co-design policy and action for the mobility, and then experiment them directly and evaluate. And in case something goes wrong or something goes against the expectation, you can redesign it and fine-tune the policy. So the use cases in this case, in the case of a living lab, involve end user, in particular the citizen, not only as observer and as people to be interviewed, but also as a source of creation, a source of inspiration for policymaker and for definition of actions. And here you have the pilot actions that we are going to develop within this project. They relate, as you can see, to service, innovative on-demand transport service implemented with autonomous vehicle for elderly user. Recall that population aging is one of the drivers of change that we outlined before. Pilot action on pedestrian and cycling route within the city, upgraded ones. The development of smartphone app offering real-time analytics and information about traffic condition. And last but not least, and this will be the case of Milan, the development of a tool for traffic flow management, a living lab for in presence of big events. Okay, and all this pilot action would see citizens and stakeholders involved in the definition. So, in conclusions, transport planning can be seen as a decision-making process that requires long-term vision. So you need to be visionary in to a certain extent, and you need to be able to deal with uncertainty of the future. Mobility solution and project should take into consideration all the three dimensions of sustainable development, the environmental one, the social, the economic one, and the societal one. And a holistic and multidisciplinary approach is required to cope with the complexity of transport system and with its interaction with the human habitat. And actually, this is what you can learn here at the Politecnico di Milano. Thank you very much for the attention.
Thanks very much to you, Pierluigi, for sharing your knowledge about planning the future of urban mobility. You can see over here a couple of links to the information about studying and enrolling here at Politecnico di Milano, so that you can find additional hints on the web.